All right, folks, let's continue with our reading of the Bible. We're doing a Bible study in John, and I guarantee you're going to find this extremely interesting. Now, below this video in the video description, if you missed the previous parts of John, you can click below the video and you can read and listen and watch the previous ones. We left off last time on John 11. Now, when we last finished our previous Bible study, we were talking about where Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. Now, there's a very powerful attempt to silence the fact that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. The enemies of Jesus at that time, they even plot to kill Lazarus because the word gets out that Jesus did this, and then you just can't stop people from flocking to Jesus Christ. So let's continue. And also, please don't forget to get your free audio Bible right below this video. Go to shotgunnow.net, click at the top of the page there, it'll say entire Bible on audio. Now, let's begin. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So you notice we're picking up where we left off before. Jesus comes to Bethany where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. There they made him a supper. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly ointment of pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the ointment. So there's this very, very expensive ointment. And what this woman does, it's really a spiritual thing, and she's basically preparing him, you know, for his crucifixion. And so she comes up to him and starts pouring this out. Now, what's kind of sad here is you see Judas, who is pilfering the treasury, he was taking money out of it, he starts saying that it's a waste. But even though this was in biblical times, even today we see this. We see this today where the world will pay basketball stars, football stars, these exorbitant amounts of money, which, you know, I'm a capitalist by all means. I have no problem with that. But, you know, what is even more value is eternal life. And then the world expects the pastors and the men of God to basically not be able to even survive. In my opinion, the highest paid person in the world should be the Christian pastor, because what they're talking about and what they do is of more value than even physical value, or it's more important than sports. I mean, what could be more important than eternal life? Remember what Jesus said, what does it profit you to gain the whole world but lose your soul? And what can you give in place of your soul? So this is my opinion. I think the highest paid person in the world should be the person that is like the Christian pastor or the head of the Christian church. I totally believe that. Now, watch this, what happens here, though. There's always been people that want to make the church where they're not allowed to have any type of money. And what it really is the people that see the money going to the church, they want the money. That's really what it is they want to get their hands on the money. It's not because they're all nice and sweet and they want to help people. It's the people see this money going to the church and they want to get in on that money. Just like what happened here. Watch this. So she pours this ointment and she's anoints Jesus right here with she pours it on his feet, and then she's wiping his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the ointment. So you have this very beautiful, respectful thing that this woman's doing, right? Mary, But Judas Iscariot, now he's trying to act like he cares for the poor, but watch what happens. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, he was to betray him, said, look what Judas says. And this is the same thing that's happening right now in society in the year 2012, and I'm sure beyond. Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? You see, this is what's happening. We see in society today is, well, these churches that are taking this money, they should go out and they should do this with the poor. They shouldn't be teaching the word of God and spiritual things. They should turn it into socialism or communism. And it is true that the churches and Christianity give so much money. It's been shown that Christians give more than, for example, people that don't worship God, atheists. There's actual studies where it's the Christians that actually have no problem with giving, even to non-religious charities they give, like cancer societies and things like that, the American Lung Association and different things like that. But of course, look what Judas says. Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? See, but here's what's really the problem. It's not that they're so good and holy. Look what Judas was doing. This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief. And as he had the money box, he used to take what was put into it. He would dip into it, you see. Now think of this. Here Mary is coming here doing something very beautiful and honoring to God. So Jesus defends her and says, let her alone. Let her keep it for the day of my burial. The poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me. So Jesus basically puts things in priority. It's God first and then the poor, not the poor first and then God. And I think that's one of the things we're seeing in society now too is a lot of the churches they've turned into socialist communism type organizations where they just get the money and they're redistributing and stuff and they don't really preach the gospel. But there's some very good, bold Christian churches that are preaching the gospel, and I think that's where our money is best spent at the ch churches that preach the gospel without compromise. Now look what happens here. Jesus says, leave her alone. The poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me. When the great crowd of the Jews learned that he was there, they came not only on account of Jesus, but also to see Lazarus, because they knew he was dead, and now they see that Lazarus is raised from the dead. So here it is. Lazarus is like a thorn in the side because this is proof and evidence of the power of Jesus Christ. So the chief priest planned to put Lazarus to death. Okay? Why? Because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. So the chief priests start losing their power, their grip, and the people are just enamored by Jesus Christ. The next day, a great crowd who had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel. And Jesus found a young ass and sat upon it, as it was written, Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on an ass's colt. His disciples did not understand this at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that this had been written of him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, look, bore witness. So it's really getting tough for these chief priests because the whole world's just like going after Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, this is what even they say. Says the reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they had heard he had done this sign. The Pharisees then said to one another, and here it is, just like what I was saying earlier, you see that you can do nothing. Look, the world has gone after him. So this is why they plot to kill him. Now watch. Let me take a drink of my tea. I got tea today. Hold on. Okay, so there's a big uproar, and just the crowds are just, surrounding Jesus. They're just moving towards him. That would happen the same thing today if Jesus came in the flesh here in the year 2012 and beyond. People, I don't care if you're an atheist, Wiccan, pagan, Christian, Catholic, Protestant, Jew, whatever, people would, Buddhist, Hindu, people would be flocking to Jesus Christ. He just had this power to do that. So the Pharisees say, you see that you can do nothing? Like, we can't stop it. Look, the world has gone after him. Now, among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks. So these came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip went and told Andrew. Andrew went with Philip, and they told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. He who loves his life loses it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there shall my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Now is my soul troubled. So he knows, see, he knows the extreme pain he's going to have to go through. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, for this purpose I have come to this hour. Father, glorify thy name. Then a voice came from heaven, I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing by heard it and said that it thundered. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Now look what Jesus says. Jesus answered, This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Well, what's this mean? Your sake, not for mine. In other words, Jesus has confidence, he has faith, he has belief, he has power. So he doesn't need this confirmation from the Father. He has confidence in that. Notice Jesus says the voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the ruler of this world, look, be cast out. You know who that is, Satan. And when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. He said this to show by what death he was to die. Now, the crowd starts questioning him. They're like, well, we've heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Jesus said to them, The light is with you for a little longer. Walk while you have the light, lest the darkness overtake you. He who walks in the darkness does not know where he goes. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. When Jesus had said this, he departed and hid himself from them. Interesting, look. Though he had done so many signs before them, yet they did not believe in him. It was that the word spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. What was the word by Isaiah? Lord, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore they could not believe, for Isaiah again said, He has blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, lest they should see with their eyes and perceive with their heart and turn for me to heal them. Isaiah said this because he saw his glory and spoke of him. Nevertheless, many even of the authorities believed in him, but look, for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. Nevertheless, many of the authorities believed in him, but for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it, lest they should be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. Let's talk about this for a moment. This is interesting. I have found if someone has a good self-image, they don't have lack of self-esteem or whatever, they don't really care about the praise of men. They would rather have the praise of God. And I would rather have the praise of God. I would rather have the praise of God than, what is there, over 6 billion people on the planet now, than have all 6 billion people praising me. So ask yourself, would you rather have the praise of men, peer pressure and all that, people praising you, or would you rather have the praise of God? And this is a big thing right here. I see a lot of folks that they're really drawn to Christianity because of the power, the salvation, the hope, the love. But because the cares of the world and them getting criticized for, worshiping God and glorifying God, they want the praise of men more. Well, that person will not stand. They'll fall away from Christianity. But the person that is more interested in the praise of God, you will not move them. You cannot shake them. They are immovable. And notice it says, "And he who sees me sees him who sent me. I have come as light into the world, that whoever believes in me may not remain in the darkness. If anyone hears my sayings and does not keep them, I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. Look at, he who rejects me and does not receive my sayings has a judge. The word that I have spoken will be his judge on the last day. For I have not spoken on my own authority. The Father who sent me has himself given me the commandment what to say and what to speak, and I know that his commandment is eternal life. What I say, therefore, I say as the Father has bidden me." All right, before we go to John 13, let's have a tea break. All righty. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And during supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, remember the money guy that didn't want the ointment to be poured on Jesus, remember he wanted to pilfer the money himself. So it's already put into the heart of Judas to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper, laid aside his garments, and girded himself with a towel. Now, before we get to this, what would happen is you would, if you had a had servants and people would come in from out of the street or out of town, they would basically, you could have your servant clean the feet. Now, when we say, oh, they're cleaning their feet, remember they didn't have sewage in that day. They didn't have sewers. They didn't have really the type of shoes that we have nowadays and stuff. A lot of them were sandals. So your feet would just get all mired with this really gross stuff, right? And so it was a very degrading, humbling thing, when someone would wash your feet. So this shocks the disciples. Watch this. So Jesus rose from supper. They just had supper, right? He laid aside his garments and girded himself with the towel. Then he poured water into a basin. So imagine this, the disciples are looking at him like, what's he going to do, And look, and he began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. He came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, now notice Simon Peter just doesn't want Jesus to really do this very humbling, degrading thing, because Peter, honors Jesus Christ, right? So look what Peter says. He says, "Lord, do you wash my feet? Are you going to wash my feet? You got to be kidding me." Jesus answered him, "What am I doing? I'm sorry." Jesus answered him, "What I am doing, you do not know now, but afterward you will understand." Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." In other words, no, Lord, this is beneath you. I honor you. You can't be doing this. Look what Jesus says. Look, if I do not wash you, you have no part in me. So Peter, in a very beautiful poetic comeback here, as you have this conversation between Jesus and him going back and forth, look at the love that Peter has for Jesus Christ. One of the most epic answers in the Bible. After, notice Jesus said, if I do not wash you, you have no part in me. Peter says, and what a great response, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. In other words, just wash all of me. I want to be with you. I want to be close to you. I want to glorify you. I want to really, just be part of your life, you know. Notice Jesus says, if I don't wash you, you have no part of me. And then so Simon Peter said, okay, well then wash every part, you know, my hands, my head, from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet, you know. And Jesus said to him, he who is bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but he is clean all over. Now watch, he's going to get to Judas here. And you are clean, but not every one of you. For he knew who was to betray him. That was why he said, you are not all clean. When he had washed their feet and taken his garments and resumed his place, he said to them, so he's showing them a lesson here, watch. Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should also do as I have done to you. So it's interesting, what Jesus is teaching is really not what the world is teaching. The world teaches to aspire to greatness, to puff yourself up, you know, to be better than the Joneses, you know, etc. Jesus is saying the complete opposite. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. I am not speaking of you all. I know whom I have chosen. It is that the scripture may be fulfilled. He who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me. So basically this, he who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me, is referring to Judas, who basically stabs Jesus in the back and betrays him, right? Even though he ate right at the table with Jesus. I tell you this now before it takes place, that when it does take place, because all the disciples didn't know Judas was going to do this. So after it happened, now they realize, you know, in retrospect, they realize, oh, that's what he was talking about, see. So he says, look, I'm telling you this now because when it takes place, before it takes place, that when it does take place, you may believe that I am he. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who receives anyone whom I send receives me, and he who receives me receives him who sent me. When Jesus had thus spoken, he was troubled in spirit and testified, truly, truly, I say to you, one of you will betray me. The disciples looked at one another, uncertain of whom he spoke. When one of his disciples, whom Jesus loved, was lying close to the breast of Jesus, so Simon Peter beckoned to him and said, tell us who it is whom he speaks. So lying thus close to the breast of Jesus, he said to them, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, it is he to whom I shall give this morsel when I have dipped it. So when he dipped the morsel, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. Then after the morsel, Satan entered into him. Jesus said to him, what you are going to do, do quickly. Now no one at the table knew why he said this to him. Some thought maybe because Jesus had the money box, Jesus was telling him, you know, go buy some food for the feast, etc., buy what we need for the feast, or that we should give something to the poor. So after receiving the morsel, he immediately went out, and it was night. When he had gone out, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and in him God is glorified. If God is glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and glorify him at once. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. You will seek me. And as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered, Where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you shall follow afterward. Peter said to him, Lord, why cannot I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. Jesus answered, Will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, the cock will not crow till you have denied me 3 times. So Jesus predicts that even Peter is going to deny that he knows Jesus. All right, let's take a quick tea break again. So Jesus continues here in John 14. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you that I go to prepare a place for you. And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way you know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know thy way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If you had known me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth you know him and have seen him. Now, let's get into this right here. Check this out. Jesus says, if you had known me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth you know him and have seen him. Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Like, show us the Father, we'll believe in him. Look what Jesus says. This is really interesting, powerful. Jesus saith unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, when Jesus says this, he's saying, look, you can count on this, I'm telling you the truth. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believe on me, the works that I shall do, he shall do also, and the greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, check this out, comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. You see that? In you, notice. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but you see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At that day you shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and I will manifest myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, there's another Judas. Judas saith unto him, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us, and not unto the world? Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and he will come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. Now, notice Jesus keeps talking about this Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. Look, these things I have spoken unto you, being yet present with you, but the Comforter, here it is, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If you love me, you would rejoice, because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it come to pass, so he's predicting what's going to happen, his death and resurrection, right? Because how could he, you know, just guess coincidentally he's going to be crucified, coincidentally he's going to die and rise again? Look, he's telling them before it happens. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it is come to pass, you might believe. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh, and hath nothing in me. But that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me the commandment, even so do I, arise, let us go hence. All right, quick tea break. Now you notice I'm reading from the King James Version. Now watch, I'm going to change it to the Revised Standard Version. And it's more of a modern type version. Like for someone that has never read the Bible, it's easier reading. I do suggest the King James Version, but this Revised Standard Version, it's a little easier on the for non-believers that have never read the Bible. With all the thouest and yay and all that, sometimes people they don't get that. I like the King James Version, but we'll read one page in the Revised Standard and then we'll go back to the King James. Look, Jesus says, I am the true vine. And well, actually, let's do something this is totally unrehearsed. Watch. I'm going to read a couple of paragraphs in the Revised Standard Version, then we're going to change it to the King James Version so you can see. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch of mine that bears no fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already made clean by the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself, unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Okay, so you got that? So now let's go to King James. So notice, this is the King James Version. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth fruit, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that he may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. See how we did that? It says the same thing, but you know, with the King James Version. We'll stick with the King James here. If a man abide not in me, look, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples. So how do we glorify God? That we bear much fruit. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends, if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not my servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. So here you have this awesome, epic moment where you have the God of the universe, the God that created the universe, the God that created earth, the God that created us. You have him entering into the world through the temporary flesh of man, through Jesus Christ, 100% God, 100% man. And you have him saying, I have a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Notice, you are my friends. He's calling us friends. And then notice this too. He says, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, notice again, that you love one another. If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world, here we go, the world would love his own. But because you are not of this world, but I have chosen you out of this world, out of the world, therefore what? The world hates you. Now, I know this is really for the Christians here, but I know if you're like me, you know, you turn on the TV, you read the news, and it seems like the world's just like going nuts. Like it's almost like it's leaving us. I know if you're watching this video right now, you've got the same feeling. It's a spiritual thing. You could see the world slipping away from us. It's insane. The world is going insane. It's like you're not even part of the world. I mean, I notice a lot of people, you know, they don't really, unless they're Christians and stuff, but a lot of the people, they don't really have the mindset that you and I do as Christians. You know what I'm talking about. I know that you know that you know what I'm talking about. It says, again, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they persecuted me, and here it is, we got to get ready for it, guys, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin, but now they have no cloak for their sin. He that hateth me hateth my Father also. If I had not done among them the works which none other man did, they had not had sin, but now they have both seen and hated both me and my Father. Now notice this. This is important. I believe it is scriptural that for someone to reject Jesus Christ is sin. And I think anyone that reads the scripture can see it. There's something even like of a greater sin to have rejected Jesus Christ. There's this passage in the Bible where it says, how can we reject so great a salvation? And I believe this carries with it a grave penalty for someone to do that. And this is what you can read the scripture. I'm sure you'll have your opinions on it, but it doesn't seem like it gives us any wiggle room on this scripture. Look, He that hateth me hateth my Father also. And then he says, if I had not done among the works which none other man did, they had not had sin. But now have they both seen and hated both me and my Father. But this cometh to pass, that the word might be fulfilled, that it is written in their law, they hated me without a cause. So look what he says here. He's talking about, if I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin, but now they have no cloak for their sin. And then he says, he that hateth me hateth also the Father. And he says, but when the Comforter has come, notice he keeps talking about this Comforter, and we're going to talk about this hopefully on the next page here, but if I don't have time, I'll just get right to the point on it. This here, but when the Comforter has come, he's mentioned that several times, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, look, he shall testify of me. Powerful. And you also shall bear witness, because you have been with me from the beginning. Okay, tea break. Bear with me, guys. Okay. This is a very important passage here. What I'm about to say is pretty controversial. Like if you're an atheist or an agnostic, you know, you're really going to get upset. But if someone's an atheist, agnostic, or whatever, and they're denying that they have this knowledge, this belief that God exists, they're not going to have an excuse, because Jesus sent the Comforter into the world, and he's providing proof and evidence and confirmation in everyone's heart that God does exist, and also that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Watch, let me read this to you. Look what it says. These things have I spoken unto you, that you should not be offended. And this is very, very important. So I'm going to go a little bit slower here. I mean, it's all important, but this is so key here. There's a key here that's going to make folks that don't understand how can we be held culpable for our sins? How can we be held culpable or responsible if someone says they don't believe God exists? Well, in fact, they do know that God exists. Watch. He says, they shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever kill you will think that he does God service. And these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things that have I told you, that when time shall come, you may remember that I told you of them. You know, so you're not going to be afraid. And these things I said unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. Now, this is the part right here I want you guys to see. But now I go my way to him that sent me. You see that? And he says, and none of you ask me, whither goest thou? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow has filled your heart. So all the disciples are really sad, because he's saying that he's going to leave them. But here it is. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. What does that mean? It's better. It's good. It's much better that I go away. Why? Look what he does here. For if I go not away, look again. The Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, here it is, I will send him unto you. So Jesus sends this Comforter, this Holy Spirit, into the world. What's it going to do? What is this Comforter going to do, this Spirit? Watch. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin. There's three things he does, look. And of righteousness, see that? And of judgment. Now, so check this out. This is heavy stuff. Jesus sends the Comforter into the world, and the Comforter is going to reprove the world of three things: sin, righteousness, and judgment. This is a helper that Jesus is talking about, this Spirit that comes into the world And it reproves all of us in the world. Notice it doesn't say it's going to reprove the believers. It doesn't say that. This helper, this comforter, is reproving the world. Unbelievers, people that reject Jesus Christ also, and also people that were unbelievers like I was, and then they come to the truth in Jesus Christ. But watch this. This here, when he's talking about the helper, this is a witness of the Holy Spirit to unbelievers, proving to them through these three things that salvation in Jesus Christ is real. Watch. He says, and when he has come, he will prove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Now he breaks it down. What does that mean? He's going to reprove the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment, this helper. Look, of sin, why? Why sins? I thought our sins are forgiven in Jesus Christ. Well, look, because they believe not on me. See, they still die in their sins. Of righteousness, why? Because Jesus is God. Look, he is divine because he goes to his Father and you see me no more. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. But he said three things, remember? Sin, righteousness, and judgment. Of judgment, because the prince of this is judged. Who's that? That's Satan. So notice, sin, because they believe not on me, because our sins are forgiven if we believe in Jesus Christ and his finished work on the cross, and we cast ourselves on the mercy of God through Jesus Christ. So here you have it, guys. This is why people will not have an excuse on Judgment Day, because this helper is convicting them of what? Of their sin. He's reproving them of their sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Break it down one more time. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Showing his divinity, he's God. Of judgment, why? Because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, here he is again, he's speaking of it, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Now let's stop here. It is not natural. It's not the default position for the natural man to go ahead and admit that they're a sinner and confess that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. The natural man wants to fight against it, you see. And the proof and evidence that you have ex-atheists like me that are now Christians actually turning to Jesus Christ is proof and evidence that this helper is within the world. If this helper wasn't within the world, it wouldn't be reproving the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. And this is why in Romans, if you look at we're going to do Romans also, it says that the belief of God, right there it says, it is manifest in them, inside of them. So you have the Spirit reproving the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment, the helper, the comforter. And Jesus says, he shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore I said that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. A little while, and you shall not see me. And again, a little while, and you shall see me, because I go to the Father. Then said some of his disciples among themselves, what is this that he saith unto us, a little while, and you shall not see me? And again, a little while, and you shall see me, and because I go to the Father. You know, they don't get it. They said, therefore, what is it that he saith a little while? We cannot tell what he saith. They don't understand, right? Now Jesus knew that they were desirous to ask him, and said unto them, do you inquire among yourselves of that I said a little while, and you shall not see me, and again a little while, and you shall see me? Verily, verily, I say unto you that you shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice. and you shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in travail, hath sorrow. In other words, when she's pregnant, going through birth pain, because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembereth no more the anguish for joy that a man is born into the world. And you know, therefore, and ye now, therefore, have sorrow. But I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy, here it is, guys, amen to this, no man taketh from you. You're going to have joy that no one's going to take from you. And in that day, you shall ask me something. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever you shall ask the Father my name, he will give it to you. Hitherto, have you asked nothing in my name? Ask, and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. These things have I spoken unto you in Proverbs. But the time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. At that day you shall ask in my name, and I say not unto you that I will pray the Father for you. For the Father himself loveth you. You see that? Jesus is saying, look, the Father sent me into the world because God loves you. He's saying the Father loveth you because you have loved me and have believed that I came out from God. I came forth from the Father and am come into the world again. I leave the world and go to the Father. His disciples said unto him, lo, now speakest thou plainly. They get it. They get it. Lo, now speakest thou plainly, and speakest no proverb. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest forth from God. And it's really awesome right here. They basically, in a very kind and loving way, they honor Jesus Christ here, and they say, look, now speakest thou plainly and speakest no proverb. And they're basically confirming what Jesus says. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest from God. Jesus answered them, do you now believe? Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that you shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things I have spoken unto you, that you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Thanks for listening, guys. God bless you guys. I appreciate you listening to this. We'll continue with John. Let's see how many more pages we got. We got 17, 18. 19. We're going to end the video now, but we're going to see how many more pages we got. 20, 21. And there we go. So not bad. And then we'll go right into Acts after that. Let me show you guys a website real quick where you want to get that free audio Bible. Hold on. If you have an MP3 player and you want to load some really good shows, we got Christmas radio show, The Lies, Errors, and Fraud of Evolution, our Easter radio show, our April 1st National Atheist Day celebration show, the Merry Christmas radio show. We did a pro-life show. We did a live evolution versus creation debate show, Atheist Colin show. I had Ray Comfort on the show. That was great. And then here's our pro-life show, Sanctity of Life Sunday, with the famous Pastor George on YouTube. Let's see what else we got. Oh, this one's really good. We got Street Preacher Saunders on YouTube. He called in and he was telling us different wild, crazy things that happened to him when he's street preaching. He gets attacked and stuff. This is very interesting. How to Survive a Nuclear Holocaust. The guy that we had on the show was brilliant. And let's see what else we got. I'll just show you one more. Let's see. Oh, this was kind of a funny show. We had live karaoke and open mic, where this is just kind of a fun show we had where people called up and they sang and played musical instruments on the radio show. And so God bless you guys. This is Shock. I love you. May the Lord bless you, keep you, watch over you. And Jesus is Lord.